Ham Radio Now, episode 129. From the ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference, September 2013, in Seattle, Washington, we are closing in on the end. In fact, this would be the last presentation if I hadn't forgotten about the banquet talk, the Saturday night banquet talk. So that's going to be the last one. That'll be episode 130, and it'll be coming out right away because I've got it all edited and ready to go. I'll make an intro to it and put it online. This, however, is the big one. This is the Sunday deep dive. It is Rob Frohne, KL7NA, and Rob is going to be talking about an introduction to Android programming for amateur radio. Holding up his little Android phone right there. This is a tutorial. Most of the talks at the DCC are not real serious hands-on how-tos. They're telling you about things. They tell you a little bit about how to do things. But for the most part, they're not real serious how-tos. This is a serious how-to. It's all day on a Sunday morning, 4 hours worth, although it is going to come to you in three programs, each about an hour long, with breaks and some gaps and stuff edited out. It worked out to about 3 hours worth of programming. So you're going to see three episodes. I will only be here for this first one. My intro is only going to cover the first one. The next two will just kind of get going. I'll have some titles and stuff, but no more me. So this is it for me, except for episode 130, the Saturday banquet. So stay tuned for that. Now, this is a tutorial on Android programming. And one of the things I thought about as I was putting this program together was, well, remember a few years ago when we were going through that big battle about code and no code? We fought it several times. And we fought it continually since the idea was proposed about, I don't know, 100 years ago. But when it got serious, some of the folks who were weighing in on that debate said, well, absolutely, we should have code. There should be a code requirement, but not Morse code. It should be computer code that you need to learn today in the, well, this happened, yeah, in the 21st century. Those were probably mostly, you know, the young whippersnappers that were coming up with that. And the typical ham radio reaction was, hey, kids, get off the lawn. So, well, after watching this presentation on programming an Android program for ham radio, and Rob is going to show you how to program a very simple application, just a rotor control, turn a knob, make your rotor move. I'm glad I learned the Morse variety of code. I don't think I'm a candidate for what Rob is teaching here, but there's a good chance you are. If you already know how to program Android programs or any other serious computer code, then you know, this is going to be low-level stuff for you. But Rob is going to, for those of you that are interested in maybe learning how to do this for the first time, never done it, Rob is going to show you how. And before I have him get into it, I guess I should tell you that he is just learning how to do this himself. As he'll say several times in the program, he's only about a month ahead of you. If you're just getting started, he's only a little bit ahead. But in the 3 hours that he's talking, he can probably compress your getting started time quite a bit. And so maybe there'll be a few more Android apps written, ham radio or otherwise, from the folks who watch this program. So we will get to that program in just a minute, but as usual, and for the second to last time, I need to thank the folks that made it possible for Ham Radio Now and me to get out to Seattle, record the programs, and put them online here for you. So one second to last time, the penultimate time, I will tell you about the folks that did that. And first of all, it begins with you, who helped out with the Kickstarter. That is the 115 hams plus three of our corporate underwriters that came up with the 12,000. You know, I really ended up getting about $11,666, even though this says 12,700. One or two of you didn't come through on your pledges, so the credit cards didn't go through. And then Kickstarter takes their cut. So it ended up with about 11.6 between you hams and the three corporate underwriters. So thanks very much to those of you who got me out there. Appreciate it very much. The corporate underwriters are TAPR itself. And, you know, I don't know how much more there is to say about these folks that I've already said. Made some pretty long spiels about all of our corporate underwriters. And like I said, I'm not really used to doing this commercial stuff anymore. It's been years and years since I've had to do it. Read the same commercial over and over again and feel as if I'm doing it the first time every time, especially for a targeted audience like this. You probably heard all these things before. But I really do want to encourage you, if you're into the digital aspect of amateur radio, to check out TAPR, TAPR.org. Stop by their website. And if you haven't been a TAPR member and you are interested in digital, then think about becoming a member. It's $25 a year, so not too big a deal. I keep saying that it's the digital aspects of amateur radio, digital software, digital programs, or digital modes. But one of the big things they've been working on is something that just runs ordinary analog HF radio, sideband, CW, the stuff we've all done. And that is these kits. And I'm looking at the ones over here, the Alex, the Hermes, the Metis. Look at Hermes. This is an HF transceiver, HF plus 6 meters. It is software-defined radio. It's one of those in the vein of what the Flex 6000 stuff is doing, which digitizes the signal from your antenna, goes through a filter, digitizes the signal, one big gulp, and then does all the processing in digital after that. They have multiple receivers, similar to the 6000 series from Flex. The Flex has taken it farther. But this is something that you can do yourself. You can build the boards. You can do a lot more experimenting playing with this system. So if that's what you want to do and you want to get into serious software-defined radio, and I think we've got a picture of the board someplace. There's one that has been built up into a box, and there's what it looks like. So that's the kind of thing that TAPR can do for you, get you into that sort of thing, in addition to the digital modes, the text-based, the data modes, the digital voice modes, things like that. They support all that stuff. So it's not purely just digital modes. It's anything that gets seriously into digital stuff in ham radio. So once again, stop by the TAPR website, tapr.org, and consider becoming a TAPR member if you're not already. And if you are, tell them thanks for supporting Ham Radio Now and getting all this stuff from the DCC online. Our next corporate underwriter is Flex Radio. I mentioned them a moment ago. And Flex is promoting the 6000 series, the 6500 and 6700 transceivers, and they've got a receiver version of the 6700. And as I was saying, like the TAPR and the group they work with, HPSDR, the Hermes and the other SDR radios that are basically build-it-yourself boards and kits from TAPR, the Flex 6000 series is a software-defined radio that takes a great big wide swath of RF from a couple of hundred kilohertz up past 67 megahertz, converts it all to digital, and does all the processing from there. Now, they do something that the HPSDR and TAPR system doesn't do, and that is that they put all their serious processing inside the radio. They've put, you know, big FPGAs, big processors, and the stuff that your computer does is no longer the heavy lifting. It's just the display, the graphical user interface. Using this thing that they call a Smart SDR, that's the software they're using for this system now. That allows you to use a much lower powered computer. In fact, they've been demonstrating things like netbooks coming soon. I don't think it's quite ready yet, being able to do it on a tablet, even a phone, being able to control the radios completely over the internet. That's what they can get when they don't have to do all the work in the computer. It's all being done inside the radio. Now, Flex still has some of their earlier series radios, the 3000 and 1500. Now, these are still fully software-defined radios, but at that level of technology, Flex was still putting most of the hard work inside your computer. So it took a lot more communication between the radio and the computer, and it needed a much beefier computer, a lot more capability on your end. So you got the 6000 series, which is doing the work inside the radio. And that lets them do a lot more with the system, like all those multiple receivers and pan adapters. But if you're not quite ready for that, and the 1500 and 3000 series are somewhat less expensive, so you can get started a little bit more easily if you want to get into SDR, but you're not ready for the full commitment of the 6000 series, then start with the 1500 and the 3000. And be sure to stop by the Flex website, flexradio.com. And our final corporate underwriter is Elecraft. And the radios that they feature, the K3 and the KX3, are also both software-defined radios. If you look at the front of the radios, they don't look like software-defined. They've got all the standard knobs and buttons and dials and displays and everything that you might expect from a traditional, pretty much all analog radio. But inside, the processing is all done in software. And that means you can download updates, changes, fixes, and program them right into the radio. So even though the radios look like they are conventional radios, they have all the advantages of software-defined radios. So stop by the Elecraft website, elecraft.com. Check out the K3 and KX3 and a whole bunch of other products that they've got available in their product line. Lots of cool stuff. Elecraft.com. So once again, thanks to Elecraft, to Flex Radio Systems, to Tapper, and to you. And now let's get on with the show. Back to Seattle, and Rob Frohne will show us how to make an Android program for amateur radio. Steve Bible, would you please do the honors?
Rob is handing around some DVDs. On the DVDs is the Android SDK for Linux, Mac, and OS, or Linux, Mac, and Windows, sorry.
Got it.
So that you don't have to go downloading it off the wireless internet, and then, of course, everybody trying to download it and it taking several minutes. So this is make it a little more convenient for you. And let's see, Gary, you ready? All right, so Gary's rolling, and it's 8 in the morning. So, Rob, we need you.
Coming.
Okay. So, everybody, I'd like to thank Rob Frohne. He says it rhymes with baloney, and I just think that he's not full of baloney. I think this is wonderful, and really, I think this is an exciting topic. The Android operating system's very closely linked to Linux. There's a lot of popularity out there. There's a lot of Android devices. And what's interesting is if you take an old Android phone that no longer is hooked up to the cellular system, if you look at that piece of hardware and think about it, you've got a computer. You got a computer that's got Wi-Fi on it, Bluetooth on it, it's got a camera, and it's got an accelerometer, and it's got a touch screen. So don't throw those old Android phones away just because they don't have a cellular connection. You can turn off the cellular part of it and then just continue using it as a regular small computer. So this is an opportunity to learn how to program these things and then make them useful, repurpose them. So again, I'd like to introduce Rob Frohne, KL7NA, and he and his tutorial on Android programming. Take it away.
Thanks, Steve. Well, let's see here. I think I'll start over here so I can see everybody a little better and move over here when we actually start doing things on the computer. Anyway, Steve gave you a very good introduction to little Android devices, and you know his little note about using old Android phones for things is very nice. Actually, my phone here is one of those. You can buy these on eBay, and sometimes they have a bad ESN or something, so they can't be used on the network anymore. Somebody said, "Oh, I lost it and turned in the insurance form, and now this phone is not good for the network," but it still works for all the kind of things I do because I'm a frugal frony and I don't like paying big bucks to the cell phone company for a service, so I just use it for Wi-Fi. And it's like a little pocket computer. It's actually very nice. So today we're going to learn about Android programming, and my goal today for each of you is that you will go away with the I can do it feeling, okay? And the first thing I'm going to tell you to help you hopefully get that I can do feeling is a little bit about how I ended up with this kind of thing. Basically, my daughter about a year ago was going out to Ohio to sell books with some of her friends, and she had to have a cell phone so she could keep in touch with us. So I had to bite the bullet and get a cell phone for her. And when I did that, I went to eBay and kind of I bought one on eBay, and you can put in a SIM card, and I sent her off with that. And you know, when I was playing around with that phone before I gave it to her, I said, this is kind of a nice little computer, you know? So I actually bought myself one, and that was kind of what got me into this Android business. I also am involved with some software that John Melton started. And then Alex Lee in Singapore kind of took over. It's called GHPSDR3-Alex. And you can look it up on GitHub. And it's actually a lot of fun because on my phone, I can, you know, run this little app, and I've got a little software-defined radio there. The server, of course, is running on my laptop at home in my ham shack. And I can transmit, and I can receive, and there's more gadgets on that little phone than I ever dreamed of when I was a kid and got into amateur radio. I mean, you know, the spectral display and all the great digital signal processing that Bob McGuire and Frank Brickell put in there on the DTTSP software and all that. So it was wonderful to play around with that. So these phones, you can get them pretty cheap on eBay, and the one I have right now paid about $50 for, and the phone is really probably about a $500 phone if you were going to actually buy one new. So it's amazing. Now you can't do quite as well buying Android tablets on eBay or other places because probably the cheapest way to go there is just to get a cheap Chinese clone. I don't know how well those are, but they don't have quite all the features that the Samsungs and Motorolas and some of these other phones do. So I kind of prefer the phone. It fits in my pocket better, and it's really quite handy. So that's kind of how I got into this. And then, as I was using that GLSDR software, and listening and so on, every once in a while I would kind of run into this problem that I didn't really like, and the problem was this. I have my rig hooked up to a directional antenna at home, and the antenna wouldn't always be pointed the right way. And that's very annoying, you know. Here you are, somewhere off demonstrating this thing, and the guy isn't coming in quite loud enough, and you'd really like to rotate the beam. And so I did work on fixing that. I bought an old Heathkit IntelliRotor, which is a rotor controller that replaces the CDE or high gain control unit. And it has an RS-232 port connection on there. So then I wrote a little back end for Hamlib for this Heathkit IntelliRotor. And after that, I could log in, remotely to my server at home with a terminal and rotate the antenna. Well, I don't know how much you guys have tried typing on a little phone, but it's not very fun. And if you're demoing this thing to somebody, they've lost their interest by the time you get done with that. So then I started to want an app that would rotate my antenna. And so this was about a month ago, and I took and said, well, it shouldn't be that hard to write a little Android app to do that. I'd never programmed in Java before, really. I mean, I've been doing this about a month. So, I have to apologize because I think Steve advertised this as being, a lecture given by an expert, and I'm not an expert. But I am basically just maybe 1 month ahead of you. So if I can do it, that means you can do it, okay? So that's what we're gonna attempt to do today. I want you to go away with the stuff that I found out in the last month that makes programming Androids so easy. Okay, that's what I'm trying to do. That's my goal today. So let me just make sure we didn't miss anything in the slides here. Those are our goals here. We're gonna, if you have your computer today, you can install the tools. If you haven't already done that, the little DVD. If anybody doesn't have a DVD, I think I left them back on the counter there with Gary. And you can grab a DVD. The DVD, all it has on it are just exactly what you can download from Google. It's the Android development tools. And there's one for Mac, one for PC, and one for Linux, okay? And 32-bit and 64-bit, those kind of things, okay? So that's what's on the DVD. The reason I have the DVD is just so we don't choke the network and everybody all of a sudden trying to download half a gigabyte. I figured that the hotel network might not handle that. Okay, so, and then what we're gonna do today is this is a kind of a workshop. So we're gonna work through together. We're gonna start from scratch and we're gonna work through developing this rotator application that will communicate with HamLive. Is that better?
That'll be a little better.
Okay.
Everybody's saying it's
too loud.
Android development tools.
Oh well, it was the latest as of about a month ago.
Okay.
And if you don't have the latest, it doesn't matter, because Eclipse has a little tool on it that keeps downloading the latest if you wish. So it will keep you up to date. So that's what's on the DVD. So anyway, what we're going to do is we're just going to program this program to communicate with HamLive and to basically, turn the rotator. Now, I don't want everybody turning my rotator at home, okay? All over the place, really giving it a terrible workout. And so what I've done is on my laptop, I can run a rotor daemon similar to the one that's running on my server at home. And basically, I'm gonna run it as a dummy rotator. And what it does is it just acts like it was a rotator and it'll report back just like the rotator would, what the angle of your antenna is. And so we can all connect to that rotator and all of us can simultaneously try and turn the thing if we want. I don't know what happens when, a whole lot of people are doing it. I know I can do it two or three, different connections. Like I can do it from my laptop, I can do it from my phone. And I don't know what happens when everybody tries to do it all at once, but we'll probably find that out today, okay? So that's our goal. Our goal is to make an Android app where we'll, if you have your laptop, you can follow along and type it in. I think actually if you type it in yourself, you will be slightly better off than if you just watch me do it. And so I brought the DVDs so that those who want to do that can. Now, on the other hand, if you just kind of want to sit back and relax and make sure you understand everything and ask questions, that's just fine as well. I've already told you about how cheap the phones are. The software, the development tools are free. The Android source is available, it's open source, which for me is very important. Anymore, I have to admit that I really don't want a radio if I don't have the source code. I had a kind of a sad experience. I bought on Craigslist a Yaesu FT847, which is a nice radio, but it had been hit by lightning. And unfortunately, the lightning got in through the RS-232 port of that radio and pretty much fried all the 5-volt logic, including all the CPUs. And when something's a CPU that you don't have the ROM code for or whatever, you're pretty much locked in to go to Yaesu to get those chips. And then you still don't even know what's going on in there, And I finally gave up on fixing that radio because even when I plugged in replacement CPUs, it started to turn on the PA, amplifier, and it would, all the CPU has lots of D to A converters, and that's what they use instead of POTS. And when your CPU is putting out, or your D to A converter is putting out the wrong voltages on all your tweak POTS, or what used to be tweak POTS, it's liable to burn something up. So I finally gave up. Now I'm just going to use that you know, the analog parts of that with my HPSDR as the filters and transverters and things like that. So I've decided that I really like open source for ham radio. It's got to be open source, because how else can you play with it? Okay, so let's unzip the SDK, and let's go to the Eclipse folder and open up Eclipse. So let me, what I'll do here is I'll get out of this. We'll just close this guy. I actually have Eclipse already running here, but basically all you need to do is unzip the folder, okay? Unzip your folder, put it wherever you want it, okay? And inside that folder, you will find, let me just see if I can find it for you here. I think I stuck those on my projects directory here. There'll be this ADT bundle. For me, it's the Linux one. You just double-click on that, and inside that, there's the SDK and Eclipse. And if you double-click on the Eclipse, then there's this program Eclipse here, and that's what you want to start, okay? That is the open-source development tools that Google uses to develop Android, okay? So that's what we want to do, and when you do that, basically, it's going to look like, let's see. I'm going to start a new one here. I'm going to close the ones that I've done. Actually, we're really just kind of reprogramming what I did before, only simplified, okay? So now we're going to start and make a new project, okay? So to do the new project, there's several ways in Eclipse. There are these toolbar icons. This thing right here is new. Or open, and there's the new one up here, you can do that, or you can go up to your file menu and go File, New, and then there's, you know, all these different new things you can do. We want to do a new Android application project, okay? So we're going to make an app. So you click on that, and then the wizard appears, and it asks you, you know, what do you want to call this project, okay? And I don't know, I guess we could call this Seminar Rotor or something, okay? Because this is the one we're doing in the seminar. And you type that in for your application name. Maybe I could put a space in here, and it's gonna leave the, you know, no space in the project name right there, so you don't end up with problems with your operating system. Some operating systems don't like spaces very well. And down here, there are several things you can select. There's the minimum Android SDK here. I don't know how much you know about Android, but Android 8 or 2.2, they called it Froyo. That's a fairly old phone now. That's, you know, probably at least 2 years old, okay? That's not a very fast phone, but it works fine for this application. And in general, when you're developing for Android, if you're actually going to put your app on the App Store, then people are going to start rating it. And if you want to keep your ratings up and you want to make it so that people really like and download your app, you need to do a lot of stuff to make sure that your stuff really works for everybody who tries it, because everybody and his brother is going to try it, and you're tempted just to try it on your phone and forget all the rest of them. But there are a lot of Android phones out there, and they have various different screen sizes, and you know, it might look great on your screen, but it might not look good on somebody else's screen, okay? And there are a whole bunch of, Android application development, you know, has gone from, you know, a long time back until now, and they're always coming out with new things. And one of the, probably the biggest problems with Android is there's a lot of different versions, okay? Because it's open source, anybody can fork it, and Google doesn't like that, but people do anyway, okay? So these are the versions you can do. My phone uses this application API 17, which is the Jelly Bean version of Android. It's not quite the latest. The latest is 4.3 here. I'm using the 4.2. But you know, you can put what versions you want in there. And this information ends up going into a file which we'll look at a little later called the Android Manifest file, which is an XML file, and it details all the things about your app. You know, if you put a API 17 instead of API 8 there, then anybody that has a phone that is running API 8, when they go to the Play Store, they won't even notice that that app is there. They won't even see it, okay? So this is where you set that up. You can change these things later. I'm always scared when I have these kind of things, you know. Now I have a chance to set this, but how do I change it later? We'll show you how to change it later. So I'm usually worried about that, but we don't have to worry about that here. So let's just go, let's go back here. There was one other thing we should have done here, and that's this com.example.seminar-rotor. You see that? Basically, you want to put your fully qualified domain name in reverse order in there, okay? And the reason you want to do that is because when you put it on the Google Store, you want that to be right. You don't want to use com.example. That's just what Google uses if it doesn't know what to do, okay? And the reason you want to do that is because every time you update your app, you will have the same package name there, and the Play Store will know to update that thing instead of make a new app out of it, okay? So it's really important. We could change this later as well, but as long as I remembered here, we probably ought to put it in here. So for me, it's like edu.wallawalla. I work for Walla Walla University, so that's that. And then I could put like KL7NA. And then the name of the program, okay? So that would keep it me separate from anybody else at Walla Walla, and put my call sign in there so that you know it came from me or whatever. So anyway, that's one thing we needed to do here on the setup. Okay, over here there's some other options. Your launcher icon. We're going to create an activity. An activity is basically a screen or some little program that's running on the Android, and we're going to create the project in the workspace. When you started Android, I probably should have mentioned it, came up with a thing and said, where would you like to put your workspace? And I just take the default there. In Linux, it just puts it in your home directory. It's a folder called workspace, and inside that, it keeps all the data that Eclipse needs, and it will save your state. So when you quit Eclipse and you start Eclipse, it starts the same way as it stopped. And all your projects are there and that kind of stuff. So I just put the project in the workspace. And I don't have any working sets. This is the only program I'm doing here. So that's that. So I go to the next thing. And then there's all these icons. Notice there's several different sizes. You have to have different sizes for different phones with different screen sizes. And so it's giving you some generic icon here, which is good for us. Let's just go on and look at that. We have a choice of what kind of activity to start. And the activity is basically, like I said, the program. I want to use just a blank activity. You can look and click on these things, and you get an idea what the other activity is. Basically, what this is doing is it's actually going to start you off with a whole bunch of code that will make this, whatever you see there on the screen, it's going to make that. Now, this has a different look than this, and there's some extra features built in here, and then there's, here's a different one yet, might be good for a tablet kind of app or something, but all I want's a blank activity. We're going to do something quite simple, and that's rotate my antenna, okay? So we'll just pick blank activity and go next. And then let's change the activity name. The activity name here is actually the name of the class that's going to run when you run this thing. Now, a class is basically like a blueprint for an object, okay? An object is something like this microphone. You know, it has certain attributes to it, only this is a software kind of a thing. And the microphone has things like it can connect to something and it's getting vibrations in the air here and things like that. There's certain things that it can get and do. And your class and our class, basically what this class is going to do is it's going to rotate the antenna, okay? So I don't generally like to use the default main activity. Let's call this rotor class. Okay, and so it's going to make a layout, and a layout is basically it's that what the phone is going to look like. And Google has made Android pretty nice so that you can actually just kind of graphically design your interface. Okay, so let's say that's good. There's some navigation types here. If you wanted to be able to navigate, you know, you can swipe and all this kind of stuff. But I'm just going to skip that. I don't need any of that. Now let me close out all the old stuff that I had here before, so we don't get confused. This is our new activity right here. I want to make sure I'm going to close this guy so that it's really closed. So here's our seminar rotor project. And this is the Eclipse environment. Maybe I should mention a little bit about the Eclipse environment, because actually learning how to run this Eclipse tool is probably about as difficult as learning Java and all those other things we're going to need to know to do this. Okay, so the left hand bar, and you can move these bars around if you want to. You know, I could move this. I think I can. Yeah, I could like put it over here and whatnot. You know, you see, you can arrange the thing just the way you like it. And this Eclipse has a thing called perspectives. And if you go up here to the navigate. Now let's see. Window. I think maybe open perspective. There's all kinds of arrangements of the basic sub windows in Eclipse that have been optimized for different things. And this DDMS is a debugging system that connects to your Android phone remotely. There's a regular debug environment that actually is, you know, got breakpoints, and you can stop your program at various places and look at the variables and things like that. And these are just, these perspectives are things that are layouts of the windows that are kind of optimized that. I mean, I could click on DDMS here, and that's what the, you know, they have a bigger window down here for the logcat and the console. And those are places where you're going to get output from the log on the Android device and from the console on the Android device through the DDMS connection. So you can go back to the Java perspective. This is where we'll probably spend most of our time, at least hopefully, if not too many bugs and so on. And like I was saying, there's a lot of folders and things over here in the packages. And so the source folder is just what you'd expect. It's where the source code is going to go. That's where the Java that we're going to write goes. But then there's this gen folder down here. And this gen folder is actually Java that the Eclipse IDE wrote for us. And then there's some library folders and some stuff down here. The bin folder is where the binaries are going to go. If you're going to put this thing on a Git repository or somewhere and you're going to share it with people, you probably don't want to include the bin folder or the gen folder, because those two things are generated when you build your Android app. So those are things that are built from the source. You only need to include the source when you're sharing things. Down here, this resource folder, RES, is very important. Basically, resources are things that your program uses that are like photos or strings and why are strings? So, you know, I mean, you could code those directly right into the program, and you certainly can here. But the reason you would want not to do that is because if you're going to make this thing internationalized, you want it to work in Dutch and Spanish and other languages, then you're going to want to make it so that you can replace those strings with something that means something to somebody in those countries. Okay? Does that make sense? So in general, you want to use the resources and make these resources external things to your program that might change when you change your country of origin, you know, on your Android settings. So there's that. And now notice under here, there's several folders here: drawable HDPI, drawable LDPI. You know, there's something in the HDPI, and there's nothing in the LDPI, and there's something in the the MDPI and so on. Those are all the icons that we made. You remember those little pictures of the little robot at the beginning when we went through the wizard? There were like four of them, right? And if we had picked an API lower than 8 that had a screen, you know, where the screens were even smaller back in the old days, then there would probably be something in the LDPI folder, okay? And so if you're going to put a picture on your screen, which, you know, you might want to on this app, what I did when I actually made the real one that I use is I went and made a great circle chart, a map of the world centered right at Walla Walla, so I could tell, you know, which direction to point my antenna by looking at the little, you know, great circle chart. You know, where is Europe? Well, about northeast or something, right? So you might want to add those kind of things, and if you do, you need to make one a different size for each of these different folders, okay? Just like those icons were different sizes. Now, down here under the layout, a layout is basically what your screen looks like. And they made for us automatically this XML file here. You can kind of, by the way, if you want to see things a little better, you can move, if I can get this thing here, move this little thing over here, and you can see that's an XML file. So, basically, this XML file is going to tell you how the screen looks. And Google takes that XML file, which basically defines there's a lot of options, a lot of properties that you can set in that XML file, and it generates the Java code to make your screen look like that XML file describes. Okay? So it's a quicker way of kind of getting code. And that code goes up there in that gen object. That's where the generated XML files, or no, Java code from the XML files goes, okay? And let's actually look at this thing here. If I double click on that, this is probably how your IDE started out. I closed all those files just to make sure I had everything closed, but here it is, and it says Seminar Rotor, that's the title of our program, and it made a Hello World application out of this. It has a Hello World here. First thing we want to do is let's delete that. So click on that guy, and let's just backspace over that. So now there's no little text box that says Hello World, okay? And basically what I'd like to do in this rotator thing is, how does the rotator work? I guess we need to talk about that. Basically, the rotator is using a TCP connection, a socket connection, between the Android device and my server at home. Or in your case, it's going to be between your Android device emulator on your screen and my computer up here when we get there, okay? And so basically, it's opening up a socket, and a socket is kind of like a network connection. It's like plugging in to my computer, you know, plugging the cable in programmatically, and then it basically opens up an input stream and an output stream. An input stream is a stream of data that you're going to get from the rotor, and the output stream is a stream of data that you're going to send to the rotor, and basically we're just basically going to send a couple commands. The only commands I really need for my rotator is, first of all, I'd like to know where is the antenna pointed to begin with, right? And in Hamlib, basically, all you got to do when you're running this thing is send a p, a lowercase p. When you send a lowercase p, it will reply with what bearing your antenna is at right now, okay? And the other thing we'd want to do is be able to turn the antenna, and they use an uppercase p, so you'll send an uppercase p and then a space, and then the bearing for the azimuth, and then the bearing for the elevation, okay? Well, I only have, this is an HF antenna and it doesn't change elevation, so I only need to worry about the first one, and I just send a zero in the second spot there. So those are the two things basically we've got to do, and when we send those commands, like the little p, it'll send us back the bearing. When we send the big p, it'll send us back a thing that says RPRT in caps, and then space zero if there was no error, and it'll space minus some number if there was a specific error, and the number on the that it sends you would tell you what error it had if there was some error, okay? So basically, that's what we're going to do. We're going to make a little connection to the to the server, and we're going to need to have a button to get the heading, and we're going to need to have a little place, a little place on the screen to display the heading. And then the last thing we're going to need is a little place on the screen, a little input box to type in the new number to tell it to rotate to this new position. Does that make sense? So we're going to have three things on our screen. It's a really simple, okay? Three things: a button to get the heading, a place to display the heading, and the third thing is just a place to input the new heading, okay? So if you notice over here, there's a whole bunch of different gadgets you can put on there, okay? I'm going to start out with a button. So see if I can find the button. Here's a button right here. So I just grab that, and you can put it over here and kind of put it where you want it. I'll just put it right there in the middle at the top, okay? And that's going to be my button to get the heading. And then I'd like a... I saw a thing, it said text view. That's where I'm going to display the heading. So I'll put that underneath the button here. Something like that. And then the last thing I needed was something to put in the information, the number, the new bearing, basically, right? A little text field to put that in. And so let's see if we can find something for that. Oh, hey, it says text fields right here. Let's check that out. Okay, so text fields. You could have one with plain text. Okay, that means you could enter in, any kind of letter that is on the keyboard. Well, let's think about that. I'd really only want numbers, right? I actually don't want them to say northeast. I want to put in numbers like maybe 45 degrees or something instead of northeast, okay? And so I think I'll put in something that's just numbers. I don't want just a person name, password. Let's see if they have something that's just numbers. Postal addresses, time and date. So, if you needed any of those, here's a number. That's what I want right there. Let's just put that over here and drop that in. Whoops. Let's see if I can move this over. Something like that. Okay, so now I got three gadgets on my screen. So let's stop for a minute and hopefully has everybody that's doing this up to speed here? Was that easy? Yes, question back here.
Hey, I'm less than 5 minutes behind you. Just back up to button and do that again.
Back up to button. Okay, so button was up here on the form widgets. And you want to go down to button right here. Grab that thing and just drag it over.
Okay, I got that.
Okay. And then the next thing was a text view. So I saw that up here, text view, it's the top one. Just grab that over and drag it over. And if it lands somewhere you don't like it, well, you can fix that later, okay? And then the last one was the text field, and you could put any of these on here, but I wanted the ones that was only a number, and we can actually change it in the XML file. There's an XML file that goes with this picture we're looking at right here. The picture is kind of easy. I kind of like the picture, but I found that sometimes you can change things on the XML file more easily than you can drag that thing around and get it exactly where you want it. Sometimes the XML is actually easier, and so it's important that you know how to do that. Notice that when I have this button up here clicked, it clicks the button over here in the outline, and then there's a bunch of properties over here. And so if you look at that, there's a thing here that says the text for the button. Here's the ID for the button. I wonder if maybe I can scoot this over just a little bit. We'll kind of squish our picture here. And you can see, that the ID, it called that button 1, right? Okay, so let's stop for a second and see. Anybody else have any questions? Are everybody up to speed on where we are right now? Okay, good. So button 1, I'd like to change that ID because really button 1 is a very generic thing. And people are going to, if you write a program, people are going to try and read your code later, okay? And it's very, very important that you make things that are descriptive, and button 1 is very generic, okay? And sometimes those people that are reading your code and trying to figure out what's going on, I've found
Sometimes that's me. And I can't remember what that crazy button one was. It was really easy to leave it button one, but it wasn't a good idea. Okay? Do you understand? So generally in Java, from what I've discovered in the last month or something, is that the way that people label things is this. There's kind of a grammar that helps people read your code, okay? Generally, a name that starts with a capital letter is what's called a class or a blueprint for an object, okay? The actual object that you build, the actual instance, the thing that you're going to create, the thing that it is built on that blueprint that the class is, that thing, it usually starts with a lowercase letter, and if there are several words in that thing, like say in this case, heading button or something, there's two words there. You would lowercase the heading and then uppercase the B on the button. That would be what you would call the object that you created if you want to try and follow the conventions, which will make it easier for other people to read your code, okay? And knowing these conventions will make it easier for you to read somebody else's code, too. And you know what I've really found out about all this programming stuff is? There is so much great source code and so much stuff available on the internet that it's almost just a whole lot of pattern matching, okay? All you got to do is find somebody else that did something about what you want, and you copy and paste that, and you try to understand what's going on there, and just match the same way he did things, only do the thing you want to do, which is maybe slightly different, okay? And it's crazy, but that's really all this kind of boils down to in a lot of ways. Okay, so we have these three things here. I'm going to change the button one here. We're going to take a break in about 3 minutes here, and then we'll come back and finish working for another few minutes on this, another 50 minutes or something here. So if you notice here, you can click on that, and then there's this three dots over here, this little ellipses here, and if you click on that, it will tell you what the thing is here, and you can rename that resource, okay? And I want to...
It's only a single dot. Yeah,
it's only a single dot. Well, maybe because I got things so squished, I'm not sure.
Well, it's only a single dot in what we've got on our
screen. Oh, really? Okay, well, possibly. I don't know. I can't... On my screen right here, it's like three dots, but this is Linux, and it may be different on somebody else's. So,
same window,
yeah. So anyway, one or three dots. So let's put in a new name here for this, and we'll call this heading_button. Now, this is going to make that thing called in the XML file heading_button, and this is not going to be the Java instance of the thing. This is the XML thing, and all the XML stuff, you want to make sure that you always use lowercase, and I found the convention for the XML stuff is to put an underscore between words, okay? So we'll just call this heading_button, and it says update references, and we want to do that because basically that's going to change all the, anywhere in the program, anywhere in any of the files where it said button one, it's now going to say heading button, and so I'll say okay. It does its little thing. And we really don't want it to say button in the text here, so if I click on that guy, it brings up this other box, and this other box is a box where I can enter in strings. A string is a collection of characters in a certain order in the computer. And so I really want to make a new string. I don't want it to say button there. When I pop open this app, you want to make an app that makes itself clear on what it is. So I guess we could call this thing, I want to make a new string here, and we could maybe have the button have a thing. Maybe you don't want to make it too long in Android because your screen isn't too big. You know, you could make it very descriptive, but it make your button really wide, right? So I will say, I will say heading. I really am kind of tempted to say get heading, but I'm just going to say heading, okay? So the new string, well, I'll call this, the string. This is actually where you want to put the Java name you want to keep for this button, string. And I don't know that we're actually going to change the string on this button, so it really doesn't matter. But I'm going to call this, this is the heading string, I'll just call it heading string, and it'll just say heading. NG, heading. Okay, so I think that'll work. And we'll say okay. And now it should say heading there, okay? So let's take a little 5 or 10 minute break, and you know, you can play around with that, and then we'll come back and we'll make a few more changes to the interface.
Okay, on the string screen that you had before, the dialog there, could you explain the differences between what I guess the Java string and the straight name are? I mean, that wasn't clear.
Okay, yeah, let me come back here. Okay, the Java string is actually the name that it's going to call that string in the Java program, which is in the generated automatically in that gen folder. If you look at right here, if I look at here, there's a package in there. And notice there's this r.java, okay? And if I actually looked at that r.java, we could go down in this Java program and we would find that that string in there. That's the program that's telling the Android operating system to write heading in there. And the string, which I type with heading with a capital H, that is the actual value of that thing that string that's going to be put in there. And if you changed internationalization, you know, you might use some other word for heading in French or something. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. Now let's see. There was another question somewhere here.
Is there other languages that you can do Android development under, such as Python or even C++?
Yes, you can do Python, you can do C, you can do C++. There's another Android development kit called the NDK, which is made for writing things in C++. And so, yes, you can do that. But for beginners, the easy thing is Java. And actually, I think a large percentage of the applications built are running in Java. And I didn't used to like Java because it always seemed like it was laggy on my computer, okay? But I haven't had that experience on my phone. I can't tell the difference generally between the ones written in Java and the ones written in C. But there are certain applications which are, you know, like maybe a DSP server or something, I'm sure you would want to use C instead of Java. But for us starting, we're just doing the easy thing, the normal thing. It's probably, you know, I'm guessing 90% of the people use, you know, 90% Java or something. So that's kind of what we're doing. Any other questions?
Yeah, no, I'm just fighting Eclipse. It can't find Java, and Java's on the Windows machine, so I'm blocked.
Oh, dear. I should have tried this. Anybody else using Windows and trying this on Windows?
Yeah, I got the same problem. I'm installing the Java.
You're installing the Java.
Right now.
Where did you find the Java?
Well, I got it from my company server.
Oh, okay. I see. Okay. Oh, interesting. Well, yeah, that's the problem. I should have tried this on a Windows machine here. It's good you got another 10 minutes to try and figure that little problem out, but I wish I could tell you. I thought everything was there. When I downloaded this thing on Linux, you know, it seemed like the whole thing was there. I didn't have to do anything. And so I assumed it would be even easier on Windows, right? But I guess I was wrong.
Yeah. It took forever to get there. You were clearing the main buttons before I could get there. So I'm now trying to catch up
on the buttons. Yeah. Uh-huh. So, you know, to do the buttons again, you go over here to the Let's see, the resource file, it's the layout. And you drag them over. And there was three of them we needed. There was the heading button, there was the text view, and then underneath that, the text edit box, pick the number one. Text view is the top thing under form widgets. Up here, right there. The top thing under form widgets is text view. That's the second one. And the last one is under text fields, and it's the number one. Yes.
What was the very, very first application that you started in the SDK? Was it Eclipse? Was it?
It was Eclipse. It's in the Eclipse folder and just start Eclipse there. Yeah, that's all I did. Yeah, I'm glad to see some resourcefulness on trying to figure out this, finding where to download Java. You're having to actually download installing the SDK. It seems like you ought to be able to do that right here. Up here, there's this Android SDK manager. Well, maybe it's actually you would want to go over here to Windows.
You don't get there because you need Java installed on the computer to even run Android.
Oh, you can't even run. Yeah, right. You got it. You can't even run the Eclipse environment because, yeah, you have to have the Java runtime. And I don't know about the Java development, but I. Yeah.
You can get Java from the ARRL website and download it, but Eclipse still can't find it, even though it's running on my Java's running on my machine.
So you got a patent.
But Eclipse can't find it.
Sounds like a patent issue. Yeah. It's a patent issue that can't.
It's a patent. Well, it says it's only looking inside the bundle. It's not looking where Java's installed on Windows.
It's in the
No.
Yeah.
Path issue. I can't change it without Eclipse running, and I can't get Eclipse open without Java, without it running Java, so we're blocked.
Catch 22. Yeah, I did have to resize the text edit. I just kind of squished it together. Well, when we start up again, we'll look at the actual XML file, and you know, yours doesn't have to look just like mine to work, right? There may be some things, you know, it's basically how it looks. If you want to tweak it so it's, more centered or, we'll do a couple things like trying to make it so the text in that text edit file starts out centered. I kind of like that better than starting over on the left and, a few little things like that. So it's basically your preferences, how you want that to look, and you can tweak on that XML file or tweak on the layout here until it looks the way you want it.
Any chance of doing this in .NET rather than Java?
No. No. Google and Microsoft don't get along very well.
Apparently.
Yeah.
If you know .NET, Java's this far away.
C Sharp and Java are very similar in syntax.
C Sharp, not yet. C Sharp, it's not far away.
Yeah, I was actually pleasantly surprised how easy Java was,
Well, why don't we do 5 minutes?
Yeah. Let's do 5 minutes. Yeah, biology, that's right.